But first, we begin our series on the legacy of President Obama's time in office. Our series is called The Obama Years, and over the next 2 weeks, we'll examine the successes, review his administration's failures, and highlight the battles that will continue during President-elect Trump's tenure. Tonight, we start with President Obama's legacy on conservation.
In his 8 years in office, President Obama has permanently banned oil and gas drilling on hundreds of millions of acres of federally owned land in the Arctic and Atlantic Oceans. He's canceled oil and gas leases on land owned by the Blackfeet Nation in Montana. He's also used his executive power 29 times to create new national monuments, protecting more than 554 million acres of water and land. That's more than the last 18 presidents combined. In August, he more than quadrupled the existing marine national monument in the Pacific Ocean near Hawaii, creating the largest protected area on Earth.
Nature is actually resilient if we take care to just stop actively destroying it.
Last week, the president set aside two new national monuments, Bears Ears National Monument in Utah and Gold Butte National Monument in Nevada. Environmentalists and Native American groups love the move, but critics have called it an egregious and arrogant federal land grab. With a new Republican Congress and administration coming in just a few weeks, there are questions about whether these efforts might be rolled back. Last week, I talked with the Washington Post's Juliet Eilperin about Obama's legacy, and I began by asking her about the significance of these two most recent monuments.
So they're both fascinating for slightly different reasons. Gold Butte is an area, it's roughly 300,000 acres, about just an hour's drive from Las Vegas, and it's got incredible petrified sand dunes, rock art. It's a very important habitat for the imperiled desert tortoise. And while it's this area where people go to hike and enjoy, it's also right at the heart of where Clive and Bundy and his family live. This is a family that's been at odds with the federal government for years.
These are the family that was involved in the standoff in 2014
exactly.
In Nevada, and then the other in Oregon.
And then also the occupation of the Malheur National Wildlife Refuge in Oregon. And so they have failed to recognize federal authority for well over a decade. They've been illegally grazing there, and so their property is right adjacent to this area that was declared a national monument, and so it's quite an interesting area for that reason. Bears Ears in southeastern Utah, which is a larger parcel of land we're talking about, 1.35 million acres, is an incredibly important ancestral Pueblo site. And so
the Native American
site. It's a Native American site where there are many tribes, some of whom live near there and some of whom have actually moved to other areas, who consider it an incredibly important and significant place. People still go there to collect firewood, to collect herbs for ceremonies. They see it has been a literal refuge over the years, as well as obviously kind of a spiritual refuge. And so that's very important. But there are real divisions there. While a lot of people think it should be protected, there are real questions about, again, the role of the federal government.
So these both are considered two of the more controversial of Obama's designations, right?
Absolutely. Essentially, he spent many years doing ones that were where there was broad consensus on the ground, where there was very little controversy, and we've seen as he gets towards the end of his term, he's been making slightly riskier designations.
With regards to the criticism, particularly in Utah, there was a lot of blowback there. I mean, Orrin Hatch, both of the senators, it seems like every elected official in Utah was against this.
Right.
What about the criticisms that they have? What are they arguing that Obama should not have done?
What they were arguing was not that this area didn't deserve protection, but that they felt that the president shouldn't do it unilaterally. Lawmakers there had been working for over 3 years to draft legislation that would have included that area as well as six other counties, where they were trying to do a mix of development and protection, give some lands to the state that they could use, some lands would go to the federal government, and so they were looking for a broader land compromise. That bill stalled in the House and didn't pass, and that's why the White House argued it had the right to, at this point, move on its own.
President Obama used this fairly old act, the Antiquities Act, to designate these. Are these on pretty good legal footing going forward?
Yes. One of the things that's really interesting about this act that dates back to 1906 is that it's fairly broadly worded and that you've had presidents from both parties use it frequently and to protect areas. And when usually it has stood up to challenges in court that basically the presidents are given broad latitude to exercise the authority.
So is there any sense, though, that if the Trump administration comes in, and there's a lot of very pro-drilling interest in the potential cabinet of the Trump administration, is there any way that they could carve these back?
They could. So one thing that would be very straightforward, where there's really no legal controversy, is that Congress could pass a bill reversing these moves, and if the president signed it, that would effectively and kill off the monuments. So that could be done. What Republicans are asking President Trump to do is to do it on his own. That has never been done. Presidents have, in occasion, altered the boundaries. In one case, Woodrow Wilson cut a monument that Teddy Roosevelt created in half. But there's kind of no court precedent for what would happen if a president on his own reversed it. There is a legal opinion dating to 1938, which says the president can't do it, but that has not been tested in court.
More broadly, how do you see these particular designations fitting into Obama's overall conservation legacy?
I think they're very interesting and significant for a couple of reasons. The first is that the president has tried to broaden the definition of what is American history and what is our heritage. And so he really has focused on recognizing areas that, for example, recognize everything from Black history to LGBT history, women's history, and Native American history,
among others, in designating national parks.
Yes, in highlighting it as part of the Park Service, and these two are a mix, but primarily Bureau of Land Management land, but basically trying to say this is all of our history and this is part of what it means to be American. So in many ways, that's what's most important. In other senses, it does connect to his legacy because he's talked about climate change when they were describing this monument. White House officials talked about this will create resiliency to climate impacts, corridors for wildlife. So there are other reasons why it matters. And he's really come to focus more on public lands and public waters in his second term. While he's done climate change from the beginning, this was not as much of a priority in his first term.
I mean, I know that not all conservationists think that Obama gets an A+. How do you think his legacy is going to be measured by history?
Right. Of course, on one level, we certainly do need to see whether things get reversed over time, and that applies whether you're talking about some of his climate policies regarding power plants or whether you're talking about this. I think there's no question that he is one of the most consequential presidents when it comes to the environment. He really has made it a centerpiece of his domestic policy and even his foreign policy. And so I think that when people look back, they will see that he really focused on this intently, particularly as he saw his term coming to a close.
There's only a couple more weeks left. Do you think he's done designating lands?
I don't think he's done yet. There are a few different ones they're looking at. They're looking at expanding a couple existing monuments that were created earlier, including the California Coastal National Monument, as well as the Cascade Siskiyou Monument in Oregon. And there's certainly, if I had to lay bets, there are a couple of historic monuments they're looking at, including one that would highlight civil rights history two in Alabama that would speak to that. There's also a long shot one in South Carolina addressing Reconstruction.
All right, Juliet Eilperin of The Washington Post, thank you so much.
Thanks so much, William.
Tomorrow, our series, The Obama Years, continues with a review of the president's education policies. On the NewsHour online right now, watch a book conversation about the history of our national parks. Plus, meet a man who planned to visit all 59 parks in 59 weeks to celebrate the 100th anniversary of the National Park Service last year. All that and more is at pbs.org/newshour.